You're all my fault. two days ago, and before we walked out, they was playing that song. And I thought, now I recognize that song. And that is beautiful. And just as we walked out, the song was over. But I thought, how wonderful. How wonderful for a place of business like that to play that song. Don't you folks think that song is a beautiful song? What a meaning. What a meaning. What a message. I'm glad that gospel songs has a message just in the song. Camry and Lexi has their weekly Bible study, and people are joining and watching them. Just announce it again.
Yeah, so me and Lexi have 3 more weeks of the series that we're on right now. It's about love languages. So we've done the first 2 weeks. You can always go back and watch them, but we've been doing them at Wednesday nights at 8:15. So join us.
Thank you, sweetheart. Gloria and I tuned in a certain ministry yesterday afternoon, and we had church in our home. I mean, Gloria, personally, having church in the spirit. A lot of people are scared to death of that term, in the spirit. I like getting in the spirit. And I sat there and I had my own church. We both had church in our living room. Folks, it's people's choice. You could have church in your home, or you can have hell in your home.
That's right.
It depends on people. I choose not to have hell in my home. I choose to have the presence of God in my living room. I choose to have church in my living room. Why would people want it any other way? How many choose to have church and God and His presence in your home?
Amen.
We don't have to wait till we get to church. It can be in our home. Well, I encourage you, have church during the week in your home. I have to have a little humor in things. It's a good thing when you and your son-in-law knows what the other is about to do. We know one another's next step almost. And I told him last Sunday, I said, Sean, do you realize that we never spoke a word to one another this morning? We didn't shake hands. And many times we don't, because we know we trust the other. And so this morning before church, time got away. Sean and I didn't say a word to one another. We didn't shake hands. But here he is, about to come and share what's on his heart from the Word of God. So people, let's just sit up and listen and let the Word of God transform our lives. Thank you, Sean.
Good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
I think, Richard, we just have this kind of, you know what I'm going to say, I think you know what he's going to say, so we just do an immediate handoff. But I will say this, Richard, thank you for laying me some foundational piece, because I'm going to talk about choices a little bit this morning. So, but, and you know me, I like titles, because I think the reason I like a title, it's not because I just needed to have the top, even though it's right there at the top, but I think I like to keep myself on task and on focus, so I do want to talk to you this morning about what it means to be chosen. So now, Richard was talking about the choices we make, and I'm going to talk about the ones that we don't have anything to do with. How's that for interest? You got your attention out there? Okay. And what I want to start with, I didn't come up with it, I didn't do a joke this morning. So just, you know, sorry, I didn't mean to smooth it. But I do want to talk a little bit about this. And I found a person's perspective to add to maybe what I could share, but I want to talk about a lesson from the last pick. And what I mean by that is, how many people remember, or do they still do, or in gym class, you're all up there and the gym teacher puts you through that terrible experience of saying, you two are captains, start picking teams.
Yeah.
Did young people have to do that, or was that just us older generation that they were forced to do that? You guys had to do that too? Okay. I know some people will resonate with this. And the person that I brought their perspective kind of came from that same thing. And I'm going to share a little bit of her perspective because I like the way she put it. She could maybe said it better than I might. But she would say, as a child, she was always the last one picked. Always. And I remember, even if I remember being picked last, I was like, is that feeling? Really? I don't have any offer? That's the best you got? But do you remember being in class, even if I didn't get picked? Watching someone else be picked last just made your heart hurt, like, really? And I know I had some people in gym class that were like, physicality was not their thing. And they'd be like, nope. And so, what was it like? The guy, the people picking were like, yeah, get my buds, get my people lined up, all this kind of stuff. And then these people last, and it's like, I'll take her. I'll take that one. Does anybody resonate with that? And this person is saying, hating those days in gym class, feeling like criminals against the chain link fence up for a interrogation line of some sort, or waiting for their captains to call their name. And it didn't matter if it was kickball, wiffle ball, red rover, or even dodgeball. Always the last one to call. And this person is saying, I couldn't hit the ball. I never made it through the human chain. You might do that. Do the young people do that anymore? I don't know, I don't date myself, because I read this, I'm like, I remember that. Green light, red light, did you guys do those too? Okay. All right, sorry. Bring everybody back, this is not just too good. But again, this person's saying, I know they're not the fastest, the strongest, the whatever, and other people make that explanation. She's on our team, a weak link. And here's what's interesting about this person's perspective of having that experience. And indulge me, if you will, because I like this. Her experience of saying, always being the last pick, did something to her that she didn't really realize at the time was doing. You know what it did? It created this acceptance of resignation within her. And a marked lack of effort. Because when you know you're the last pick, what does it mean? What's the expectation for you? Not much. The people putting you out there, what are they thinking? You're out in the outfield picking dandelions. They have no expectation you're going to contribute to what they're trying to do, which is win this prize in gym class. Does everybody have a trophy from gym class that makes them feel so special that's up on their mantle still now? That is the culmination of what it was in life. I'll never forget, there's a movie, and I don't remember the movie name, but I love this phrase in the movie. They were talking about the typical jock that was the bully, he's bullying the guy that obviously did not have the physicality to do come back. And I love his comment about the gentleman. He's in year four of best four of his entire life. Or year three of four of the best years of his entire life. Like, this is the best it's going to get for that gentleman that's trying to bully me and thinking he's got everything in control of his kingdom, and I don't. And the point is that this, and this is what's interesting, is that teachers have to recognize this. Now I'm going to speak to those that are getting started in the teacher realm and others that have got a teacher mindset, or maybe that they've worked in those fields. Recognizing that in young people that have had that resignation of, why try? Because I'm not special enough to be picked. There's nothing in me that wants to be picked. And I love this phrase. Students, see if you resonate with this. Students will live up or down to the expectations we set for them, won't they? And there are so many that this becomes a self-fulfilling prophecy. You've heard that term before. That is, the point is, not being picked, not being special enough to be on the team or at the forefront. Did you ever have that experience in gym class where it was the reverse? And finally a gym teacher would say, all right, and they picked two people that weren't the most athletic, and it was kind of like, cool, they had an opportunity. I'm going to pick people. Well, they might say, you're going to lose the game. So what? I'm picking you. You're picking them. They're picking dandelions in the outfield. Why are you picking them? Because I see something in them. Okay. So now we're going to flip gears. and from that mode, because I think that story just resonates with most people that acknowledge that whether you were picked or you weren't, or you know what it feels like to be up against the chain link and you're last. What do I have to contribute? Why do I want to try? Well, who cares? But I want to say a couple things from this morning, because I want to change that paradigm for everyone, because it doesn't matter our level of physicality. And I will give you a positive note. This person that wrote that story said, you know what? Sporting things and physical things weren't my forte, but I threw myself into my academics. People started pushing me. I had a higher expectation. She excelled at it. And she made a note. She said, you know what? I went back later in life and ran a marathon. She's like, I think I just want to prove to those kids that didn't pick me that I could do something physical. But I didn't need to prove to them. Do any of us need to prove to those people in high school or grade school class that are trying to tell us to pick them? But here's what I want to say to you from God's word. And I've got a bunch of them. So indulge me if you want to on that. John 15:16, Jesus says, again, red words, right? Red letters. You did not choose me, but I chose you and appointed you so that you might go and bear fruit, fruit that will last. And so whatever you ask in my name of the Father, I will give you. And can I keep going? Because I got a bunch of them. Thank you. But you said yes, so let's go. Okay. Ephesians 1:4. He chose us in him before the creation of the world to be holy and blameless in his sight. Before Jesus, before everything, you were chosen by him. The one that matters to you the most anyway. The one that counts the most. Keep going, right? Faith comes by hearing, hearing by the word of God. To me, the best thing I ever do for myself, if I'm feeling down, disheartened, anything, is pick this up and start reading. Or start reading. If you're going to scroll social media, make it about positive things, because scroll scriptures and positive uplifting messages and stuff, that's what we need. Especially when we feel like we've been picked last again in my life or whatever. Let me keep going. 1 Peter 2 and 9. I have a bunch of these, so I'm going to rattle these off. You're welcome right now if you want to come follow with me. I love this. You are a chosen people, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, God's special possession, that you might declare the praises of him who called you out of darkness and into his, the King James's marvelous, the wonderful light. Think about that. Let that resonate for you. The creator of all things. Me? Why? What did I bring? What do I have to offer? And I'm taking my so many stories. What's the song that talks about what I don't have to offer, this tiny gift? I can't think of the song talking about. I love it. It's like, here's my best offering. It doesn't look like much, God, and you still want me? You want me on your team? Of everybody out there? Here's another one. Ephesians 1. This is a great one too. If you are disheartened or downtrodden feeling over this kind of situation, grasp these scriptures. If you don't get my list, Google God chose you and you'll get this. There's Bible Hub and all these wonderful ones. I'll just give you a bunch of these. And just go through those and meditate on those. Here's another one. Ephesians 1. In love, he... Now get this word. This is a wonderful word. I'm always a wordsmith. I know the girls are too. I love to pay attention to ones that have a deeper meaning. Predestined. That's an awesome term. Us for adoption to sonship through Jesus Christ in accordance with his pleasure and will. To the praise of his glorious grace, which he has freely given us in the one he loves. Okay, there's a bunch to unpack there, but I just, one of my favorite things, you know, there's different memes on my videos that can touch your heart and stuff. One of my favorites of all time, I love to watch soldiers come home, you know, those are the touch your heart strings, but my other favorite is to watch someone finding out they've been adopted. Like, And you'll see, and I can picture this one little girl, and it's like Christmas time, and she's reading the paper, and they that's like her gift. She opens it, it's like a piece of paper, like, what in the world? And she starts reading, and you just see the moment her face just breaks. What? I'm being adopted? I mean, and you can just so resonate, because, I mean, why does it hurt? Why does that tug at you? Why is that so emotional? Because at that moment, you know, she didn't have a home. Now she's got a home. She's got a dad and a mom. She's got a family that chose her, that wants her as part of their fold, to treat them like their very own, to treat them like their one of my kids. I mean, I talked about this before. I don't mind talking about it again. When it comes to my kids are my all. I'll give them everything. I'll give them what I got. I mean, not just my money, but my time, my effort, my all. I give my life for them. Why? Because they're my kids. And you know, that comes with any other family. I've talked to my sister about this before. It comes to family. I know there are some people that dismiss family. I think that's completely, I'm trying to think of the bad word for that. Bad. Because they give it up. I don't, like I said, so I'm just saying. But why'd you throw away the family tie that you have here on this earth? And I said to her before, I say to my kids, I say to anyone that's close to us, my church family, I'm not going to throw any of you away. You're my family. And I don't care. And the Bible says this, you fathers on earth, being evil, being in sinful state and nature, fallen state, if you don't have to be good to your kids, how much more the Heavenly Father? So if I know what it's like to be good to my kids, I mean, my kids don't have to ask me for supper tonight. I mean, this sounds silly, but it's like, Dad, can we eat tonight? Like, no, they might. We're the family tonight. We're like, when's mom coming? But that's a little funny. It's like, they're not worried they're not going to get a meal. Right? But when it comes to my kids, they can have everything from me. I'll give them my all because, why? They're my kids. Because you know what? They don't have to make any certain election. I choose them. They get my all because I choose them. I choose to give them everything I got. Now, think about that. Think about what I'm telling you from just my own perspective. And now, think about our Heavenly Father, who chose us before the foundation of the world, chose you and I. You were picked first in line from the foundation of the world. There is no last in line with God. He chose you. And so precious. Ugh. Okay, so can I keep going? I got a few more. We got a little more time. Because we have this foundation. You know, you look at the New Testament, and it's always built on the Old Testament. But he started this with the children of Israel. They were the apple of his eye. They were, you hear that term, tamim. They were something very special to him. He chose them. He predestined. That's a great word. And in Deuteronomy, he talks about Moses. Can I read this? Okay, sure. No one's going to stop me. Moses tells the children of Israel why God chose them. This is why I like this. The Lord did not set his affection on you to choose you because you were more numerous than other people. You were the fewest of all. But it was because the Lord loved you and kept the oath he swore to your ancestors that he brought you out of the mighty hand and redeemed you from the land of slavery. It sounds like our lives today, folks. Out of the bondage that would hold us, the snares that would so easily beset us, the sin, the things that shackle us in this life. And he's telling us the children of Israel as a foreshadow of what he's going to do through his son, Jesus. Therefore, the Lord your God, he is a faithful God, keeping his covenant of love to 1,000 generations of those who love him and keep his commandments. Once again, we see that God's choice is not based on any merit.
That's right. Yeah.
You can't do more to earn it. You can't act a certain way for God to choose you. Now, we go back to, what's the song, Chasing Down? What's his name?
Reckless Love.
Yes, thank you. I do like that song, even though people say, someone loves not reckless, and we've talked about that before. It's not reckless. Our perception as a human being is to look at God and say, God, it looks reckless to be chasing after me because I don't deserve it. Because in our humanity, in our fallen state, we look at him that way. He's too good for us. Has anybody said that about themselves? Why would God want me?
I'm a mess. I've made mistakes. I went the wrong way in life. I departed from him. I cursed him. I doubted him. I've struggled in my own humanity. Why would God choose me? And yet, there is not one single thing any of you can do to make him love you more. He already chose you. He chose you out of this. He adopted you into the family. And you think about that. I think about that for a moment, that he offered this free gift of, now can you imagine the video of a little girl being adopted in the family? Not have a family. Can you imagine her being like, I mean, you'd be like, what? You don't want a family? You have no family, you don't want a family? Nah. I don't mean to be indifferent about it, but now, can you imagine when God chose us before the foundation of the world, allow his son to go to die for us willingly, and people do this over God? I can't even imagine that, because when I talk about this, there's a term, and we do this a lot of times in our Christian known, where we refer to things and people are like, I don't understand that. But there's one, it's called the doctrine of election. And so it's kind of referring to what we know as an election. We go out there and teach somebody. We pick a politician, we put him in office, supposedly, and we go through this procedure. And so there are people that look at this terminology saying God choosing, like, well, why does he choose some and not others? And I've often said this, and I'm a big fan of the field of apologetics. I love Sean and I both kind of resonate with that. I love studying the gospel needs no defense. It rests and stands on its own. But I love that scripture that talks about every man should have an answer for the hope that lies within him, or should understand what it is that you believe. And so when you think of it in that term, I want to talk to those people that doubt or struggle, knowing that I've been through those things myself. But those that would outright reject God and say, I don't want you. And I'm like, but he chose you. But if we don't want it, he's not going to force himself on us. So God choosing us, we have to accept that free gift. And this is one of those tough realities. People say, why would loving God send somebody to hell? He doesn't. Ever. What happens? He chose us, and we didn't want the adoption. We don't want it. I mean, that sounds, it's like, can you even believe it? Why wouldn't you want adoption? I don't know. I don't have the answer for that, because I want it. I want that familial relationship. I want to be with him. And I've often heard, you know, most people that don't believe in God, and I don't want to meddle too much here, but most people believe we're all going to heaven somewhere. But I always think this, too. I always want to challenge somebody with that phrase and say, wait a second, you don't even believe in God, or you don't really like him, or you don't care for him. Why in the world do you want to go and spend eternity with him? Like, you don't even like him. What do you want to go spend eternity? You just think heaven is your own heaven, I guess. I don't know what that is, but everybody can create their own heaven, everybody can create their own God. I guess that's why the Bible talks about one of the Ten Commandments. No other gods before me, like as if there is one. I told you I'd be mad just a little bit. Sorry. Yeah. Most of this we talk about that, so I'm not going to get into the weeds this morning with the time I have left on election. But the God chose us, and there are plenty of scriptures talk about that He has the power that He can form all up to honor or dishonor. And the point is, if we're here and we don't want Him, and we don't want to be chosen, He's not going to shove us into the kingdom. It's kind of like, you know, that free gift, dinner bell, here's dinner's coming, come and get it. You know, your parents don't typically do the whole eagle, shove the worms in your mouth, right? Maybe when you're little. Maybe little ones right now, right? Chloe now, still kind of shove, she started to shove her own food in, but Riker's got to be. Isn't that weird? How come human babies have to be animal babies pretty much get out and start doing their own thing? Why are we so helpless? You ever thought? No, I'm getting off on a tangent. Sorry. But this is why it's so important to recognize when Jesus had the discussion with Nicodemus, his comment was, you, Nicodemus, he was challenging Nicodemus, but he actually said, you must be born again. And Nicodemus got so beside himself, he said, wait a second, what do you mean? How can I go back in and be born out again? That makes no sense. And he's like, no. Let me give you a little deeper meaning, a little deeper than that, baby. It's not just a physical birth and a physical death. It's a spiritual rebirth.
Yes.
When those little kids are adopted, things are different. Right? And many of them will change their name, whether you do or not. But the point is, they now identify with that family name. Things are different. When he talks about us being reborn in the Spirit because of him and allowing him to work through us, I identify differently. I am now put on. When Jesus Christ, I like this term. People say Christ is Jesus' last name. Nope. Christ means anointed one. It means to put on Jesus Christ. To be in him, in him, in us. That's the Holy Spirit indwelling. Now we're going to get into a lot of doctrine that I don't have time for. But the point is, I identify with him. And that's why the Bible talks about us being heirs of God and joint heirs with Christ. Whoa, that's a little nervy. Joint heir with Christ, and he said, I'm leaving and you're going to be greater than me. Whoa. Why? Because you were chosen. Because you're special and you didn't do a thing to get it. All you did was accept his free gift and allow yourself to take on his name. Those that are married and others are like adoption, that same thing. You take on their name, you take on their personnel, persona, status, everything. Holly doesn't need me to sign the check. She can sign the check just by herself, and money goes out of the account. Doesn't have to be my name on it. Why? It's a joint checking account. I'm not saying signing God's going to give you money. I mean, we're not into money. I'm sorry, don't take me. Just, she's able to act like me. Just like I can act like her. We're the same. Okay. Anyway. Sorry. Okay. I do want to do this then. I have always prepared a lot of extra. I can give you more. We can go till. I was only going to go till one. Is that okay?
Fine.
Let's keep going there. I think I do. I want to just do this. I want to reinforce then what we've kind of talked about. And I want this most importantly to just sink in. And I want you to meditate on this week. Oh, Mr. Homework lesson out there too. I want you to meditate on this premise and kind of what I'm talking about, but I want to reiterate for you. I don't know what this last week, year, or month, year has been like. Maybe you've been, listen to this, maybe you've been pastoral promotion. Okay. Maybe you've been serving divorce papers. You didn't see coming. Maybe you keep seeing pictures of friends getting together for fun nights out, and you're not. Maybe things seem like they're falling apart. We've been through a pandemic, and a lot of people are hurting. And you read stories that I hear, and my heart is moved by the angst people are going through. God's heart's moved too. Many people feel overlooked, unwanted, disregarded, mistakenly thinking, this is critical, we mistakenly think that other people mirror, that God mirrors other people's attitude. We think the guy picking us in gym class is what God thinks of us. That's where we make the mistake. We equate that and think, since I didn't get chosen in this life, God thinks the same. But that's when we have to go out to this word and realize that is not how he thinks. Can't be further from the truth. 2 Thessalonians 2:3. You, my dear, you're not only loved by God, but chosen, regardless of how others view you. Ephesians 1:4 talks about from the beginning of time, he chose you. Long before you were thought about, or you were a twinkle in your daddy's eye, or whatever you like to say, but long before that, you were chosen. If no one ever sees your value in this life, God does. Right now. So, is there a purpose? There's a purpose for everything under heaven, and we are a part of that purpose. In our limited eyesight, many times we can't see it. We just have to put on his eyes. Give me my, I love that song. It was a give me your eyes that I can see the way you see God. So I will see with my own limited vision in this human frailty. I want to see with your eyes. Give me new eyes. Give me something that lets me see like you do. Because people's opinions are going to change, just like the rotation of the earth. I love this. But God never changes. So, stand firm on this. Focus. Keep your eyes focused on Him. That's what I want to emphasize. Stop looking to the right and left. The Bible talks about look up. That's what we need to focus on our salvation. You and I were worth dying for. Regardless of what anybody else thinks, you're deliberately loved and deliberately chosen. Father, I thank you for your goodness, your blessing this morning. Lord, you're a great, big God. Lord, your words bring comfort and life. Always. Always, Lord. Because I think what we get off is we quit going to your word. We, in our ingenuity, intelligence, whatever we think that we have within us, our faculties, we think we're going to figure out life on our own, or we're going to scroll social media and that's going to give us a new insight to live life today, or numb the pain, or whatever that's going to be. Instead of going back to you, you have the words of life. You have the keys to this life. When they asked you, Jesus, show us the way, you said, I am the way. We just need to focus and follow you, and we'll give you all the glory. Help all of us to stay focused on you more this week. Love you, Jesus. Amen.